Hi everyone, this is Smriti. Welcome to QA Automation classes. So today is the class 19 and today we are going to learn how to implement the log4j into the existing framework. So why exactly log4j, right? So you might be wondering, we have system.out.println which logs the output to the console, but what is the need of the log4j again, right? So when you see the console output, right? So console outputs are for one particular run only, right? Suppose you are running one script. So after running that script, whatever the system.out.println statements are there, those will be printed, right? So those will get printed here. But and now let's say there are thousands of the test cases, okay? Let's say an entire regression suite you are running. So you are running the entire regression suite, it has thousands plus test cases. So what will happen there? So you keep on running 1000 test cases, it will take some time. After some time, when the execution is done, you come back and see, you can see the what happened to the failed test cases, why exactly they have failed. Suppose few test cases failed, so you can come and open them and you can see why exactly they have failed, right? So you either you can go through the console, whatever the console statements are there, you can understand, or you can go to the log file that has been generated, right? And there you can see the log related information, like those specific like println statements will be replaced with the log statements, and that will be generated and kept inside a log file. Okay, so let's say you are not going to work on that one because you are occupied with some other work and you want your colleague to take care of that failures, right? To look into that failure and fix it. So let's say there are 1000 test cases that has been done. So there will be some 10,000 or 20,000 of the SOP statements are there. So that will be logged into the console. So you have to go to that particular, find that particular test case which has been failed out of those statements, and then go and copy that and give it to your colleague to look, which is not a very good approach. So what you can do, you can share the log file location and say, okay, hey, this is the timestamp on which it has failed, you go and check. So the your colleague can go and open that log file and go to that particular timestamp and can understand what exactly happened at that particular timestamp, what is the exception got raised, which test script got failed, right? So what is the exact exception, all those things will be listed. And there is one more benefit of the log4j is like when we are generating the log4j, right, log files. So every time we have an option to keep on appending the output to the existing log file, okay? So but in the console log, every time you run your test script, the earlier statements, println statements got erased, and for the current run, whatever the SOP statements are there, those are executed and shown over here. But in log4j log file, okay, so if you are generating a log file, so you can configure that instead of rewriting the existing content, it just go and append, so that it serves as a history also, right? So you can understand what happened a few execution back, right? So what is happening with the current executions, you can also have a history of the things over there. So that is the main reason of the using the log4j. But how to implement the log4j, right? So if you are following my tutorials in our TDD framework session, right, you have seen log4j, right? So let's go to QA Automation classes dot blogspot dot in. Okay, I'll just show you. So here you go to log4j dot to dot xml. Okay, so we are going to use the log4j 2 because the log4j 1, there were so many vulnerabilities and it is no longer supported. Okay, so if you go to the Maven central repository, let's say Maven central repository, okay, Maven repository, you go and open it and you type log4j over here. Okay, so let's say log4j, okay, and let's hit enter. So Apache log4j, open this one. So if you see legacy version of the log4j logging framework, log4j 1 has reached its end of life and is no longer officially supported. It is recommended to migrate to log4j 2. So if you see, up to 1.2.17 was there in the 1.x, but everywhere if you see, all the versions has the vulnerabilities, right? So instead of that, they're saying, okay, you go to log4j core, and that is the log4j 2. So you can click on this one and here you can see this is Apache logging framework. So now you can go and see the stable version, there is an alpha and beta version, we are not going to move that. So you can take this one, so we are going there. So let's go to log4j 2.xml and try to understand what exactly. Okay, so let's understand the log4j, what is the use of log4j. So log4j is used to capture the runtime logs of the application or our automation framework execution details, right? That's what we have already covered that one. So we can configure the information we need and that can be shown on the console, so that it becomes easy to understand the flow, or we can start keeping the log information into a file and we can see the details there as well. Okay, so the benefit of creating a log file is that at any point of the time you want to refer to the any of the execution, you can do that. Okay, and log4j, log4j 1x has vulnerabilities, so we are going with the log4j 2. Okay, so that's what we are doing here. Log4j core and log4j API, these are the two things we are going to use. Okay, and if you are following my framework development session, in the TDD framework development session, you might have seen, right, I have there was a separate video on understanding the log4j itself. Okay, I'll leave that in the comment I button, you can click and go through that one. So there I have shown you like how to download the dependencies through the pom.xml, and then what are these log labels are there, right? So if you see, there are 8 log labels are there. So first is the off, then fatal, error, warn, info, debug, trace, and all. Okay, so if I'm saying off, if I'm saying off, so no logging at all, so no logging will get generated. Okay, nothing will get logged. If I'm saying fatal, so whatever I'm saying log.fatal, those fatal related messages will be printed. If I'm saying error, so then fatal and error both are going to get printed. If I'm saying what, fatal, error, one. If I'm saying info, fatal, error, one, and info. If I'm saying debug, so fatal, error, one, info, and debug. If I'm saying trace, then if you're saying log.fatal, some message, log.error, some message, log.one, some message, log.info, some message, log.debug, some message. So everything is going to get printed on the console. And whatever the file, if you're printing to the file, that also going to do. Okay, so this is the log level, right? So if you see, first one is off, that means nothing will be printed. Then is fatal, only the log.fatal related info will get printed. Then error, right, log.error. So basically if you give log.info, so if you in your code you are giving log.info, log.one, log.error, log.fatal, all those are going to get printed. Okay, makes sense. So I would request you to go through that session. I will share that in the I button, you can click and look into that. Okay, so okay, so now let's understand how, what is this XML file, right? So now we said, okay, so we'll just download these dependencies, and these are the different log levels are available, but we have to use it in the code, right? So how exactly we can use it? First, we have to create log4j 2 dot properties or log4j 2 dot XML. There are two ways we can have the configurations. Okay, so configuration can be done in two ways. So here I'm just mentioning log4j 2 dot properties or log4j 2 dot XML. So there are the two configuration properties file. Either one is fine. You can go with either one of them. You don't have to go with the both. Okay, so I'm just mentioning here log4j 2 properties, but actually we're using log4j 2 dot XML. Okay, so and the file name should be log4j 2, right? Because we're using the log4j 2 versions, and then we have to keep it inside the resource folder, right? And if we keep it in the resource folder, log4j is going to scan it, enter project directory, and find this configuration file. Okay, and there we have to define something, right? So what we have to define in log4j.xml, we have to define two things. Okay, one is the appender. What kind of the appender we're going to use? So appender means where exactly you want to log in. So I'm saying there is the first appender is a console appender, and we're going to print to the standard output. Okay, that is nothing but your console. Okay, and we're going to follow some pattern. In some pattern it has to generate. So hour, minute, second, and these are, if you go, we'll do one thing, we'll put that and we'll go through the runs, and we'll see and we'll compare what exactly is that this pattern. Okay, so similarly we are having the file. If you see, I'm saying, okay, so go to this dot log folder, and inside that create a file called app.log. okay, and inside the app.log also I'm using the same pattern. Okay, and appenders loggers. Okay, so root level I'm saying info, so here the hierarchy will come into the picture. Okay, so usually what we do in the code, we most of the time we write the info, right? Sometimes occasionally you can also add warn, error, and fatal messages. Okay, so if you want to add them also and you are saying info, then all those information you can see on the console, but usually we'll say info and we'll set the log level to the info. So whatever we have given, those things will get printed. Okay, so now let's go to IntelliJ. Let's go to our pom.xml. So let's add the dependencies. So Maven repository. Okay, take the valid stable one, 2.3, right? This is 2.3. yes. Okay, so copy this one, log4j core. So go to the dependency section and here add log4j core, and there is one more, log4j API. So go back, and you can search for log4j API also, but here I can see log4j API. Okay, cool. This one and copy this one and keep it here in the dependency. So now if you see, both of the log4j API have been added. So you go and save it. Okay, so Maven clean validate compile verify package. Okay, so now if you see this log4j core and log4j API, that has been added. Okay, so control S, just save them. Okay, and if you see, clean, validate, compile. Let's compile. Okay, so done. So now let's see, let's make changes to our automation scripts. Okay, so what changes we need to make to our automation script? Let me see log4j over here, it should be present here somewhere. Log4j, see, logging log4j 2.23 and log4j code, these two got added over here, right? It was around there earlier and these two got added. Okay, so now what I need to do, let me close this one and let me go to the base steps. Okay, so let's start implementing from the base step. So what exactly we did in the base step? Okay, so first we have to define the logger. Okay, so what exactly is the logger and how we can define that one? Log4j2.xml, let me quickly check one more time. Okay, fine. So I have already added the log4j2.xml in the resource section, right? So this is exactly same as what I was showing you here. Okay, so this is exactly same file. Okay, so I just copy pasted over there. So here you should have log4j2.xml where we have the console appender and we have the file appender. Okay, makes sense. So now we have to make changes to our code base. So let's start with the base class. Okay, so first we're going to the base class. We have to import a few things. Okay, so what is the base class? Base steps. Okay, so in the base steps, let's import first. Okay, let's say import. What we are going to import, we are going to import org.apache.logging, right? So logging dot log4j is coming, yes, select that one. Then we have to import logger and log manager, both of them we need to do. So first go with the logger. Okay, and similarly we need to do the log manager. So import org dot apache dot logging dot log4j dot log manager. Okay, so both the things we have imported. So now these things are going to get used. So now first we have to define. So what you are going to define, we're going to define the logger. So let's say private static, not static, let's say private logger. Okay, so logger. So you have seen this logger is nothing but your interface, right? So public interface logger. So for this logger interface, we are going to define a variable. Okay, and now you cannot create the object of the logger interface, so you need to go through the class. Okay, so how to do that? So let's define this logger, right? Okay, so instead of logger, just let's say log. Okay, and so inside this, now open URL, so try. Okay, so let's go and see, properties has been loaded. So here we say log equals to, so log manager. Log manager is the class. Okay, so log manager. Okay, dot get logger. So get logger. Okay, so inside this get logger, what we have to give, we have to give the class name. Okay, so there are two ways we can give the class name. Either you can give the name of the class, fully qualified name, like I can give here like automation utilities dot, okay, dot base steps. Okay, so base steps, this is one way to give, and another way we'll see dynamically getting the class name. Okay, when we go to the other class we'll give, but here why we are giving that also I'll show you by changing this name to the dynamical name, and we'll see what is the issue with that one. Okay, so we'll see that later, but now let's update all those system.app.println with log.info. okay, so yeah, so this one should be updated to log.info. okay, so log.info, and here also log.info. so log.info, this is also done, and here also log.info. okay, driver is closed, so base step is done. Okay, so after the base step, okay, so changes, we need to changes, make the changes to the step definition. Okay, so step definition, let's go to our step definition classes, and page object classes also we can make. So let's go to the step definition, and again we need to import those two, right? So let me copy this one first. Let's do one thing, let's put these two imports everywhere first. Okay, so sign up or login page also I can put. Okay, user home page, step definition. Okay, so now print. Okay, so in the step definition I have already gave this log manager and logger, and now let's define private logger log. Okay, so let's say private logger log, private logger log, and then log equals to user navigation application right here I can define. So let's say log equals to what we're going to say log manager dot get logger, okay, dot get logger, and here we can have the dynamically getting the class name, right? So how to get the class name dynamically? Let's say this dot get class, get class dot get name, okay, so get class dot get name. So this is going to get the name of this class, and how we are going to do log manager dot get logger, this dot get class dot get name, this will dynamically get the name of this class and it will show, okay, in the response, right, whatever the console we are printing, okay. So let's go and update this SOP statement. Do we have any SOP statements? No. Excuse me. Okay, so these are, we can, okay, I have not implemented anything, but here we are printing. I don't want these values to go to my log file, okay, this is just for the credential as the map I'm trying to print. So okay, I can have log.info here, no worries, log.info, okay, and where, here also log.info, okay, log.info, okay. I think we should have started giving this log.info everywhere, so but we have not given, right? So let's have that in the step definition, okay. So let's go to the top. The first one is user navigates to the application, right? So for this step, okay, so user navigates to the application, we can give let's say log.info user navigates to application, user navigates to application, okay, and when user click on sign up or login link, right, so home page dot click login link, okay, after that we can say log.info say user click on login link, but let's say here are we writing the statements, then it will be duplicated. Click on sign up or login link, okay, so if you're saying that, so here instead of saying here, we can say here, just say user trying to click on login link, okay, so here also you're saying user navigates, okay, open URL, so here we can put, so here user to navigate to application, okay, so user navigated to the application, okay, so just give some meaningful messages over here, guys, okay, and here sign up login page should be displayed, okay, so now you can say log.info, here give the message, so verifying sign up, you say sign up or login page, verify sign up or login page, okay, and login page is displayed, okay, so similarly here you can say log.info, log.info, you can say user is closing the browser, you can say trying to query the browser driver or something, right, so let's say double quote trying to quit, okay, so quit browser, okay, and user enters the username and password, user is, you can say log.info, so sorry, small log, okay, small l, log.info, so you say user is entering username and password, okay, just give the meaningful messages like that, okay, and user clicks on the login button, right, so say user is clicking on the login button, log.info, okay, so here you say user is clicking on login button, user is clicking on the login button, okay, User is clicking on login button. Okay, BTTON. User is clicking on the login button. Okay, and the application should navigate to the logged in user's home page. Okay, so here logged info. Let's see. Sorry, you can say logged info. User is user verifying application is navigated, right? Application is navigated to where? User home page, right? User home page. Clicked on the logout link, right? So log.info, let's say user is trying to click on logout link. Okay, so this is one other thing. Okay, and here I'm not giving it, that's okay. User enters the username and password. At the data table, and here as list, here as map, both are same. Okay, but I can give just one like okay. So log.info, here you can say user is trying to enter credentials. Okay, here I can say using map, and here I can say the same thing using list. Just copy data just for the console logging in. Okay, it doesn't really matter. Using list. Okay, so this is how we have updated our step definition. So what is the error? Control S. Okay, I forgot the semicolons. Okay, here one more. Okay, fine, all the errors are gone now. Okay, so now the next one is page classes. Okay, so we have already added to all the page classes home page. So now so time to declare. Okay, public driver driver, and let's say private logger log. So let's say private. Okay, so logger, I'll say log. Okay, and capital L here. Okay, private logger log, and we have to initialize the log, right, with the dynamically capturing the class name. So inside the constructor only, let's do that. So you will say log equals to, so you will say log manager. So log manager dot get logger, right? So get logger, and here within that you can say, right, this dot get class dot get name. Okay, this is what you can say, and remove this with log.info. okay, done. Then go to sign up a login page. Okay, so here private driver driver, here did I make it public or driver? This will be private. Okay, sign up a login page and user home page, these two places we need to implement. So now here also private, let's say logger capital L. Sorry. So logger log, and inside the constructor, okay, log equals to log manager, okay, dot get class, get logger, and inside the get logger you'll say this dot get class dot get name. Okay, and just replace system dot out dot println with log dot info. Okay, let me copy this one and I can replace the other SOP statement. So okay, replace done. So this is all done. Then user home page. Okay, so now here also private logger log, and here log equals to, just say log manager dot get logger. Inside the logger you can say this dot get, sorry, okay, so here inside the parenthesis let's say this dot get class dot get name. Okay, so we are done, and replace SOP with log.info. Okay, I think we are good now. Okay, so all the sign up or login page is also done. Okay, so all the pages are done. So after we are done, okay, we can user home page is also done. Okay, so we are done with everything. So now the next step is let's run and see the log folder and the file in the console. So you go to the log_project2.xml and you say we have given the folder location is slash dot, dot means in the current directory, just go and dot means the parent directory. Okay, so go to the current this folder only, inside that create a log folder. We don't have a log folder over here, right? So in create a log folder and inside that app.log you should create. Okay, so let's go and run. Okay, Maven run. So let's go and check our feature file. Okay, login page. Okay, user login feature. So we have how many test cases? 1 and 2 test cases are there. Okay, so Maven run, let's run it and see. So what happened? Unknown lifecycle cycle at the rate smoke. I think here I'm providing something, edit configuration. Okay, I don't have to give the tag. Okay, clean test. I just want to run everything. So I'm saying clean test. Okay, just run. Where exactly I'm missing? User home page. Okay, my bad. Okay, just run and see. Started test script execution. We'll wait for the execution to finish. Okay, so entering valid username and password, logging in and log out. Okay, fine. Okay, cool. So all are there smoke. So let's see what is the runner configuration, what we have given. Okay, we can see the logs over here, right? Okay, fine. So let's see, log folder also got created, but let's go to the configuration first and understand what is the Java test runner. Okay, so let's go to the runner and text request at the rate smoke. Okay, so let's go to your feature and see smoke, which one is the smoke. So one is smoke. Okay, so pass the test data inline. Okay, you might be wondering why only that one got invoked, because we are saying at the runner at the rate smoke, so only smoke is there. And if you see, okay, so let's understand your log4j2.xml and what we have given and what we are seeing. Okay, let me open this one here. Okay, or I can show here only log4j2.xml. okay, so pattern is %dhh, that means hour, so 13 hour and 59 minute, and this is the second and this is the millisecond. Okay, and this is coming from the main. Okay, and info, we are saying log.info, right? So this is giving the step definition dot open login page step definition. This is giving me the fully qualified name of that particular class from where it is getting invoked. Okay, so user trying to navigate to the application. This is the message. So you have seen here is the message, right? So message is user is trying to login to navigate to the application. This is nothing but your log.info, what we have given in the open login page step definition. If you go to the open login page step definition, the first one, right? So here user trying to navigate to the application, right? And after that, user navigated to the application, here user navigated to the application. Okay, so now what happened after this? We went to this we don't have to give this one here, because already for each actions in the respective page class or the base steps we are giving those information, right? So now go to the base step dot open URL. So now the control is in this base step class, and in this base step class we are saying what is that here, navigated to the application log.info. So here you should see like it is coming from the base step. So how exactly we'll see? So here you see automation utilities dot base steps navigated to the application. Okay, and then again the control goes to the step definition, and the step definition we are interacting with the home page. Okay, so clicked on the sign up or login link. So similarly, you can understand how the step definition and how the respective page classes are getting called in the sequences over here. Okay, so you can use your automation script. Okay, you can use your log4j implementation. So let's go to the log folder and open this app.log and see the logs getting created and generated over here. Okay, so if you see here also, similarly how exactly it was there, right? So similarly it is coming there. So now trying to quit browser, driver is cool. This is the fast run, this is the fast run related details, and then when we ran it one more time, this is the second run details. 1403, if you see, right, 1403 is the second run. So here you can see this 1403 related console logs and the console logs and file log also getting created. And here if you see, it will get appended for each execution, it is not going to overwrite. So 1359 also there and 140304 also there. Okay, so let me commit the changes. Commit. So let's say so these are all on staged, right? So we can stage them. Stage, okay. And okay, so commit messages implemented. Implement log4j 2. Okay, commit. So this is the commit. Let's go to git. Let's see. Implement log4j 2. Okay, so everything is committed now. So that's all to this class, guys. We'll meet in the next class. If you guys have any questions or doubt, please ping them in the put them in the comment. I'll get back to you as soon as possible. If you guys are really enjoying this session, I would request you to subscribe to my channel and share this with your friend and colleagues so that they can get benefited out of it. See you then. Bye bye.